Rose Sanctuary.
All right, well, I think we will get started. So, welcome everybody. My name's Kathleen. I'm an Interpretation and Visitor Engagement Coordinator here at the Golden History Museum and Park. So just a few things before we get started. Most of you today are members, so thank you for support and joining us today. We appreciate it. We are recording this program and it'll be up on our YouTube channel. And if you are a member, you obviously have access to some special programs as well. And if anyone needs the restroom, it is just straight back here down that hall, as is the water fountain, if you need that. We do have some Kleenex back here as well. So just kind of a little housekeeping there. So now on to the reason that we're actually all here. So our presenter, Todd Laugen, a faculty member at Metropolitan State University of Denver since 2005. He teaches American history and supports K-12 history education. His published work includes The Gospel of Progressivism, Moral Reform and Labor War in Colorado, 1900 to 1930, and Colorado History Detectives, Teaching Historical Literacy to School-Age Readers, which is available online. So thank you, Todd, for joining us. We're excited to see your program.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And thanks, everybody, for coming out. It's great. Nice to see you all. I'll try not to get in the way, so you know, I'll block in time. So, I'm excited to chat with you about political cartoons, just a little bit about how I came to this topic. I was doing research on the book that Kathleen mentioned about Colorado progressive politics about 120 years ago, 130 years ago, and I kept running across the cartoons of this illustrator, Wilbur Steele, in the Denver Post. I used some of them in the book, but this has become kind of a second project for me, thinking, or a third project, I guess, thinking about how to pull these together into a book that would allow folks to get some context as they're looking at them. Political cartoons can be a little bit impenetrable at first. You know, there's so much embedded in their historic moment. We can look at a cartoon or an illustration today and know all the different references quickly, but it's hard for us looking back 120, 130 years to get embedded in that world. So I hope to use the cartoons particularly to explore some of these questions. You know, first of all, can cartoons fight corruption? That's the basic question, and I welcome your thoughts on this. So please weigh in with questions and ideas. But I'm also interested in masculinity and women's activism. Masculinity in politics is an important theme, an important issue for us to be thinking about. And of course, Colorado is a really interesting place to think about women's political activism, because women get the vote in Colorado so much earlier than other states. We're the first state that gave women the vote, right? Wyoming Territory gave women the vote. And then Utah Territory gave women the vote in 1890, but Colorado was the first official state in 1893. So I want to take you back to that earlier period around 1900, 1910, and explore some of these issues with you about politics and corruption, and how we can interpret that through cartoons. So we'll come back to this cartoon in just a minute in a little more detail, but I would just ask first if you recognize any symbols in that or any familiar references. What do we think?
Elephant
and the donkey, right? We've got those two symbols of, I've heard of before, political parties, right? Parties at the time, yeah. So we've got those in the corporation stable, you might notice up above them. And they are to let or to lease, to rent out until next fall. So more about that in just a minute. So I thought we could also just frame this in the context of the current election for Denver mayor. I want to zoom in specifically on Denver politics tonight with you, because our cartoonist that is the featured artist, he focused a lot on Denver, being a Denver Post illustrator. So we're coming up to a mayoral election, and as you may know, there are a lot of candidates, five of them women, which is important and interesting to us. Two of the women are pictured here on the left, two of the male candidates on the right, and in the news lately, there's been a lot of talk about the amount of money that has been raised by these candidates. raised over $1.5 million for this mayoral election, right? It's a lot of money. And of course, questions we might ask, you know, where does that money come from? Any thoughts? Where do candidates get their money when they fundraise?
Corporate donations.
What's that?
Corporate donations.
Okay, corporations possibly donating.
Individuals.
Individuals, hopefully, yeah, as well, right? Those are the most common sources, right? There's some public funding available this year, too, for the Denver election. Some candidates are funding just with some private funds of their own, but also there's public funds available for them. And just so we can be thinking a little bit about the kinds of issues that animate mayoral races, a couple of key ones, housing and homelessness, have been important ones, as I'm sure you're probably aware. Crime and the economy, two other big issues for Denver right now. So anything that you think is missing from that list that the Denver mayoral candidates should be talking about or dealing with? If you were running, what would you be promoting?
Just school
curious.
Safety right now.
Okay, school safety, yeah, yeah. The tragedy at East High School, just, I had a student teacher who was there that day too, trying to keep the class going together. It's just devastating to hear the stories. Other thoughts on issues?
Transportation.
Transportation, important one for a city to deal with. Infrastructure, like specifically
roads.
Roads. Freeways?
And roads.
All roads. Potholes. Even
potholes.
Down to that level, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Important issues for cities, right? These are all viable and important issues. And they were all important, honestly, 120 years ago, too, when we're thinking about the political corruption and how to fight it at that time period. These were all important issues for Denver, too. So some of the problems, though, that were a little different, if we look back, say, 125 years, you know, industrial accidents were a serious concern. Colorado mining accidents, mining deaths, were a really significant problem. Hundreds of people killed in mining accidents every year. It's really remarkable how many people risk their lives just to earn their daily bread. In Denver specifically, as we'll see today, saloons or bars were a really big and controversial issue. Prostitution and gambling, those three were particularly worrisome to a lot of progressive era reformers and people interested in trying to challenge corruption in Denver. And then, of course, I want to focus with you a lot on political corruption and the political party system, the Democratic and Republican parties, and how they posed problems that reformers wanted to fix. So we have a photograph and a cartoon here, right? So we're focusing again tonight on images that don't move. Films were just being, they were invented a little bit before this time period, but very short, very focused, very simple by our standards, and films weren't used in political campaigns around 1900 or 1910. But images like these were, and they could be used by different candidates for different reasons. This photograph on the left was taken by a Danish photographer, a Danish-American immigrant in New York, but it captured the crowding that was a problem in a lot of places. Less of a problem in Denver than in New York, for sure, but it was a concern for folks at the time. But on the right was a political problem that Denver reformers were also very interested in and concerned about. And here we have a political boss. His name was Boss Tweed. He was the head of the Democratic Party in New York City. William Tweed was his name. And the cartoonist famously drew Tweed looking a lot like this. And in this case, he's standing next to a ballot box. It looks really like a glass jar. So ballots were cast in there. And we can see underneath, imprinted on the stand, in counting there is strength. Any sense of what the cartoonist might have had in mind with that? In the counting there is strength, it appears.
Whoever was doing the counting might have more power.
Okay, right.
To determine the outcome.
Right. So elections in our U.S. government system are run very much by states and even local government entities. So it's not, there aren't very many rules in the Constitution about how elections are organized. And elections around 1900 were certainly different from today. There were a lot of concerns about fraud. There were a lot of concerns about manipulation. And you can see this if you imagine the system running a little differently. Elections were not secret or private events. You didn't go into a little private voting booth. They were somewhat semi-public events. So a ballot box like this might be on a central table, and say we could have an election in here, for instance. The ballot box would be kind of here in the middle, and at the door there would be two sets of ballots: the Democratic Party ballot, the ticket, and the Republican Party ballot or ticket. Parties printed their own ballots. And you could just check a box at the top of the ballot indicating, I vote the Republican ticket. I vote everybody on that ticket. Or Democratic Party ballot. And if you didn't like someone on the ballot, you would scratch. You would scratch out a name. You would check the ballot and say, I vote for everybody but this guy. It was usually a guy, right? And then you would walk up and drop your ballot into the ballot box. So it was a publicly, semi-public event often. And this was happening in Denver as well as New York. The ballots were also color-coded, so it was pretty easy to see someone voting the pink ballot or the blue ballot. So this created a lot of opportunities for, shall we say, manipulation, especially because sometimes voting even was conducted in saloons. Mm-hmm. Sometimes saloons were public spaces. There weren't a lot of public spaces in a place like Denver. So you can imagine, too, the saloon owner might have an interest in the outcome of the election. The saloon owner might be, say, a Democratic Party activist recruiting votes for the Democratic Party. And if someone walks in and asks for the Democratic Party ballot, checks the box, pops it into the ballot box, that person could walk over to the bar and get a free drink, right? And if it was mostly semi-drunken Democrats in the party hanging out at the saloon, when a Republican walked in and said, I want the Republican Party ballot, I want to vote that ticket and put that in there, right? That person might face some harassment, some verbal abuse. Sometimes even there were fights that broke out in polling places. So it's a different kind of political scene than we're familiar with, for sure, in this era around 1900, 1910. So in the counting their strength, but also in kind of keeping an eye on the ballot box, right, as Boss Tweed is doing here. So, some differences, if we're thinking about cartoons and how they're trying to fight corruption, just a few observations, right? If we're thinking about 1900 versus today, right? The public sphere, how people talked about voting and campaigns and politics, was shaped a lot by political parties, of course, like it is today, but it was also shaped a lot by newspapers. That was the most important media that produced information about campaigns and candidates. There were images like the ones we're going to look at tonight, photographs, of course, drawn images or photographs. There were the two parties. But again, the newspapers played a big role. There were a lot of newspapers in Denver. The Denver Post and the Rocky Mountain News were two big ones. There was a number of others. There were almost 10, 11 newspapers in Denver. There were some that served the African American community, like the Denver Star. So it was a political culture shaped a lot by print and a lot by pictures. Today, of course, newspapers play a little bit of a less central role. I don't know if anyone gets a subscription to a newspaper and has it delivered to your house. Okay, a few people, right? Most of us read online. I'm sure young people tend to read online, yes, more. We might get our news fed to us by Facebook, even, on our phones. So there's a different kind of political culture created there, isn't there, with the news sources, and we want to think a little bit about that sort of difference. This is still a relatively new world we're living in, though, right? I mean, Facebook was only invented 19 years ago. It hasn't even been 20 years that Facebook's been around. The iPhone has only been around since 2007. So it's not been very long, really, about 15 years there for smartphones that give us political news and shape our election decisions in some way, influence, let me say that, influence. So we're thinking a little bit about different sources of political information, and I'm, again, having us think about the still images, photographs, and especially, again, cartoons. The big question, can political cartoons fight corruption? I'm just curious, what do you No? Yes? No?
Sure.
It could, but they also cause it.
Yeah.
Okay. They could fight corruption, but they could cause corruption.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, good point. Yeah.
Yeah, they could cause prejudices to be built.
Uh-huh.
You know, like when we were in wars with Japanese people, they would do all kinds of stuff about yellow people.
Yeah.
They would build up all that hatred.
Right, good point. Another example of those images manipulating people, right? How do pictures manipulate us? Is really my question. You're right. We could be influenced in different ways here.
It depends who they're representing.
Okay.
This perspective.
Mm-hmm. Right. Absolutely. So we'll think about that in the context then of these Denver political contests about 120 years ago, thinking a little bit again about men and women in politics trying to change the political landscape, change some of the political conditions, some of the voting practices that even I was just describing. So just a quick kind of overview of this time period and other issues that engaged reformers worried about corruption, worried about problems in politics and government. We call this often the Progressive Era, mainly because the people at the time used that label. They thought of themselves as moving America in a progressive direction. They were improving what they found around them as serious problems. And they were often focused in these four areas: regulating business. This was an era with very few regulations. There were no OSHA rules, occupational safety, health administration rules about hand washing in the bathroom, about workplace safety. There were no 40-hour work week rules, no minimum wage laws. So it was somewhat of a free-for-all for workers, working folks. And there were concerns that business needed some kind of regulation. And one good example is highlighted in this cartoon here. This was created soon after a fire broke out in a New York City garment factory called the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. And there were several hundred women between the ages of 18, 19, 20 working in this factory, mostly Jewish immigrant women, and a fire broke out on the seventh floor of an apartment complex, really, in New York City. And the women were unable to, the doors were locked by the manager to keep union organizers out. So the women could not escape, even though there was a fire rushing through this factory. And some of the women chose to jump out of the windows to try to survive, but they were jumping 7-8 stories to the ground. So most, all of them basically jumped to their deaths. It was a horrible tragedy. 150 young women died in this incident. And the fire department only had ladders that reached to the fifth floor. And the fire department was also largely controlled by Tammany Hall and Boss Tweed, who I had pictured earlier. So there were calls for not only government reforms, but political reforms as a result of that horrible disaster. But we can see here a cartoonist illustrating what he thought was the problem, right? Profit and interest and rent that was paid formed this sort of deadly triangle that could lead to the deaths of female workers. It's a powerful image, thinking about profits leading somehow to death. There was this movement then to think about regulating big business that's important for us just to kind of keep in mind in this context. Another important goal for reformers at this time we could call social justice, a number of different crusades or campaigns. The obvious one that's pretty famous is women's suffrage. That, of course, culminates in the 19th Amendment in this time period, which gives women the vote, right? So that was the national suffrage amendment. Women in Colorado got the vote, again, 1893. So by the time of the 19th Amendment, women in Colorado had already been voting for almost 30 years. So there's an interesting history there to think about what do women do with that power and that influence. But Colorado women were also influential in trying to persuade men. They did have to convince men that women should have a vote in other places. This is an example of a poster produced not from Colorado, although it raises an interesting theme for us. Give mother the vote, we need it. And I've always thought it was interesting that they didn't say give women the vote.
Yeah.
Any ideas why they would have, the creators of this poster would have said give mother the vote?
Emotional ties.
Okay.
Generates
empathy,
regenerate
empathy. Okay. Everybody loves them.
The mother.
His mother, right? Hopefully. Yeah.
Can you repeat what some of the people say in the front?
Sure,
sure.
Emotional ties. And could you volunteer again, Judy, what you were saying?
Oh, just there's an emotional connection. Everybody's got a mother.
Yeah. Everybody's got a mother, emotional ties. Yeah.
Well, the premise is to help the children.
Uh-huh. True, right. We have little babies marching, right, in support of women's suffrage. What could be dangerous about that, right? Why would a man oppose
marching
mothers
babies.
Having the vote, marching babies? Yeah, it's very disarming. Well, it's interesting too, because it for us, I think it introduces this theme of how women think of themselves in political situations. And there were also a lot of activist women, as we'll see in Colorado too, who thought of themselves as mothers with political power. And they thought of their political influence as reflecting their experiences as mothers. So that kind of maternal thinking is going to be important, as we'll see.
But there were fewer women in other roles too at that time.
It's a good point, right? There were a lot of professions off limits to women, certainly business, it's very difficult to rise up in that time period as a woman, right? Yeah.
Yeah, on that same vein, women were expected to get married.
Uh-huh,
and it was
right.
Not a good choice if they didn't.
Right. And we are talking about this interesting era when feminism is just slowly taking hold. The first activist who would identify as feminists date to right around 1912, 1913. So there was a pretty widespread assumption among men, and certainly a lot of women too, that these were the important roles for women to become, to marry, to have children, and to stay and care for those children. Although, of course, a lot of women had to work because economically their families couldn't support, you know, a stay-at-home mom with kids. So there is that issue coming in too. But we see this just in general as a kind of social justice movement that's important for this time period. There were other progressive era reformers, certainly black women activists, black men, focusing on the injustices of Jim Crow, racial segregation, discrimination, and violence even that the black community faced. So there's a movement in this time period too to organize and try to challenge those injustices. So a third area that we can think about in terms of reform would be what we might call social control. So a couple of examples. Prohibition. The idea that alcohol should be illegal in the United States. It's hard for us, I think, to understand why did people get so excited about that. These progressive era reformers were really, really obsessed with alcohol and saloons. And the cartoon here, I think, gives us a bit of a sense. So I don't know if you can read, anybody can read the writing on the tentacles of this. It's an octopus in the center. Kind of hard to read, but it's got this label around the base of the head called saloon. So the saloon or the bar is represented here by an octopus. And then the different arms say things like political corruption, partnership with thieves, gambling, trafficking girls, defiance of law. All kinds of bad things happening in saloons, apparently, right? So again, if we imagine that you could potentially vote in a saloon, we can begin to see why we might be concerned about political corruption in saloons. Saloons were also places where single immigrant men could go to find out not only about where to get a drink, but they could get employment tips. They could find a cheap place to stay. The only women typically in saloons were in fact prostitutes. It was not a respectable place for middle-class women to go. So they would never have set foot in a saloon in 1910, 1915. So we've got, again, that suggestion about prostitution going on here. And then, of course, gambling, right? So there were a lot of moral problems going on in saloons that these reformers are concerned about. And the cartoon, I think, offers an interesting image of that, right, as an octopus. And the fist wielding the vote is represented by some sort of sharp object, a knife. It's being stuck into the saloon. And it comes from, can anyone see where?
Prohibition Party.
So the party devoted exclusively to prohibition. And there were a number of these. Colorado had one as well. They typically were organized locally. It's hard to imagine a whole political party devoted to just getting rid of alcohol, but they had some influence at the time.
I mean, you could see this like when marijuana laws were up for debate in Colorado, like the same exact
tentacles. It is interesting,
you know,
right,
yeah.
Right. The fears that kids might be corrupted by that, yeah. Were there cartoons of marijuana as an octopus?
I was just saying, probably not the octopus, but I do remember political cartoons.
Okay, I'm collecting these sort of crazy octopus cartoons, so let me know if you see one. Yeah, no, that is interesting, you're right. It is a kind of connection there.
And the saloon is the head.
Yeah.
The center of the
body. Yeah, the saloon is the center, yeah. So we will see in just a few minutes a lot of focus on saloons and prohibition, in fact, and how important that was for a lot of reformers, especially women activists in Denver and Colorado broadly. So the fourth area that we'll focus mostly on tonight for these reformers was what we might broadly call good government campaigns, cleaning up government, trying to get rid of political corruption. And that involved challenging the boss, the director, the man who is in charge of the political party network or the machine. So I mentioned a little bit about the two political parties, but the machine could operate in a number of different ways. The boss of the machine could often run a bar or run some sort of business that benefits from government contracts, would want to be sure that Democrats, when they are elected, say, to the city council, and they have they're going to give a bid to build an infrastructure project, that they hire Democratic contractors, that they hire Democratic plumbers, and again, to build or refurbish, say, Capitol buildings or government buildings. So there were city contracts involved. There were saloons involved in the network. There were ward healers, locals, activists for the parties who would go out and make sure that the locals folks got to the polls on time. The police were also controlled and influenced a lot by the political parties. And so on election day, the police would round up the prostitutes in the neighborhood of, say, Larimer or Market Street in downtown Lodo in Denver. That was the red light district for Denver. And they would say, you're going to the polls and you better vote Democratic or we're running you out of town. So this was also a big concern for the reformers, right? That coercion that the police could exert as an extension of the party machine. So again, reformers were concerned about this sort of public voting scenario that I've described. And they said, why don't we make voting more private? In fact, let's print a ballot that has both parties' candidates. Let's have the state or local election commission produce the ballot rather than the political parties producing the ballot. Let's have it counted by the local election commissioners. So these were some of the kinds of reforms. And then a couple of others that date to this period, the idea of direct primaries rather than the political parties nominating candidates, smoke-filled back rooms, having people vote on a list of, say, Democratic or Republican Party candidates, choosing that person to stand for the general election. That's an innovation from this time period. And then initiatives, allowing people to just vote on a proposal. If they agree by majority, it becomes law. They can bypass the state legislature or the governor. And marijuana is an example there, right? That was approved by initiative for us. That was an example of this reform in action, the recall and referendum being other ways to try to check the power of parties in state government or legislatures or city councils. And here we have another New York cartoon that dates a little bit before the period that we're talking about tonight. This one's from 1870. Again, it has Boss Tweed right here from New York, the Democratic Party boss. But more prominently, we've got a tiger. The tiger is pouncing upon, anybody see? It's a little hard to see. Okay, yeah, I've got it written out for you too, but yeah, a female figure, right? So we've got this female figure on the ground, her hair is all messed up, that's the least of our worries because it looks like she's about to be devoured by a tiger. We've got a ballot over here broken, a ballot box, ballot bowl shattered off to the side. And we've got the law written here that's torn. So what does the tiger represent? A zoo animal that's escaped.
Fierce.
What?
Fierce.
It's fierce.
Yes.
Yeah.
So who's Tammany?
Tammany, that's the name for the Democratic Party machine in New York City.
How did that come about? What is Tammany?
Tammany, it was the name of an Irish fraternal association, kind of a fraternity of Irish immigrants. But then they had a clubhouse, they met, they began to influence the Democratic Party politics, and they slowly took over the Democratic Party machine in New York. So they became a kind of model, if you will, for party machine politics.
So that's what the tiger represents?
The tiger, I think, represents the Democratic Party. This was an alternative image in this time period for representing political parties. And if we look even at the Denver Post, there are some early cartoons that show the Democratic Party represented by a tiger. But more commonly, we see it represented by a donkey. That shift is just happening in this time period. But it's an interesting image thinking about the political meaning here, right? Lady Liberty, what does she represent? She seems to represent freedom. She represents law. She represents voting. All being threatened by the party machine, right, by this animal. So keep this image in mind as we move forward and think a little bit about Denver, too. So just to help put us on the map with some more famous progressive era reformers, you may have heard of the guy in the middle, Teddy Roosevelt, Republican Party president for two terms. On the left, probably the most famous woman activist of the era lived in Chicago, Jane Addams. She ran a settlement house, which was a kind of social service organization before the federal and state governments took over some of those kinds of functions. But she was also outspoken against political corruption and in favor of women's empowerment, women's political activism. She rarely got to vote. She spent most of her life without the vote because Illinois was fairly late to give women the vote. But she was still a very influential woman activist. And then on the right, a Denver attorney who led the Progressive Party, a third party program in Colorado for a few years, Edward Costigan, an attorney here locally. So we want to then, thinking about context of reforms and the concerns of these activists, I want to come back to our question, can newspapers fight corruption, cartoons specifically fight corruption? And here we want to focus on the artist that we'll look at more consistently tonight, Wilbur Steele. So he drew cartoons for the Denver Post, like this one. This was one of his introductory cartoons in 1897. And you can see he's got little toys and little, I don't know what these are, little puppets. Any ideas why he would have drawn all these little creatures? As he's carrying his artistic sketchbook under his arm,
I think the smokestack is industry.
Okay, yeah.
Can't tell what the little snowman-looking guy, maybe government?
Yeah, he says water company.
Water.
I think he's got like a fire hydrant on top.
Yeah, okay.
So a utility, which was a private utility in Denver at the time, the water company was. Industry represented, maybe tramway. He's got written in small letters on this sort of odd smokestack head that he's got. And then we've got a GOP, a Republican elephant, and I think maybe a Democratic tiger over there around the corner. and for good measure, a zebra is thrown in. I'm not really sure what the political symbolism of the zebra is, but you know, his tools, right, that he's bringing with him as a political artist, trying to represent visually for readers what's happening in the political landscape of the day.
That's when he first arrived in Denver?
He went to East High School, actually, so he grew up in Denver. He moved from Illinois as a young boy, but went to East High School. And he drew for a rival newspaper before he arrived at the Denver Post. But he spent 27 years at the Post, and I was mentioning to Judy at the beginning, he drew cartoons almost every day, 5-6 days a week, for 27 years. They were single-frame cartoons, as we'll see, and the one at the beginning, the Corporation Stable, was an example. And they were typically featured right under the masthead. So if you were looking at a paper on a newsstand folded over, you'd see Denver Post, and then you'd see this cartoon. That was the most prominent feature of the cartoons. And I've been reading lately even of some Italian immigrants who were describing how they learned English and how they learned to read and understand American politics. And they said, well, I read the Denver Post and I looked at the cartoons. So it represented a kind of symbolic language for talking about government and political issues at the time. So he had, I think, more influence than a lot of people give him credit for. When he passed away in 1925, one activist said, if we can get steel behind us, the battle is won, right? His influence is really profound in local government politics. So we come back to this one here, this Corporation Stable cartoon with the Republican elephant, the Democratic donkey to be rented until next fall. And the voter is saying, dang it, I ought to own them all the time. Voters should be in control of the party. So a novel idea, right? Instead of the corporations funding the parties. So this had some basis in reality at the time. One activist, a guy named George Creel, often wrote for the Rocky Mountain News about the political corruption that he witnessed in Denver. And he complained that the tramway company, the water company, the telephone company, the coal companies, the smelters, all private individual firms, but he complained they were operating together to control both Republican and Democratic parties and to influence both tickets, right? The candidates running on each campaign. So both the parties did have political machines. They were both active, not only in the national level, but you know, locally in Denver. So this is a big concern, right, for these kinds of reformers. They're also concerned, like this political reformer over here, Edward Keating, who wrote for the Rocky Mountain News. He complained of a city election in 1903. It was a carnival for the united election thieves of both parties, which resorted to fist fights and clubs to clear the polling places of watchers. So observers who were trying to ensure a fair election. Fights broke out, money was supplied by the gambler, the breweries, the water and the tramway companies that flowed with lavish hands, and more money being spent than ever before to manipulate the voting. This was about an election to create a charter for Denver city government. Initially, Denver's mayor and administrators were appointed by the governor. So Denver lacked what was called home rule. They didn't have local control over their city government. So in 1903, there was a charter amendment proposed to give Denver home rule. And reformers were concerned that there were two versions of the charter. The first one would have promoted more of these kinds of moral reforms that I've been talking about. And Keating complained that those party activists turned out to defeat that moral charter. So we're talking about some pretty significant problems. I mentioned about the police driving prostitutes to the polls. Another favorite tactic was to register dead people. And then when they don't show up to vote, someone's got to cast their ballot. One of the party loyalists can do it for them. Right? I'll vote again. I'll vote for that dead person who didn't show up today, right? Oh, there's another dead person who didn't show up. Well, I'll vote again, right? Vote early and often is the slogan of the party machine. So these were some of the concerns of the reformers, and as we'll see, some of the concerns of Wilbur Steele with his kinds of cartoons. So in 1904, after the city charter was ratified, a new charter, there was an important election for mayor that featured a candidate named Robert Speer, Bob Speer. Bob Speer ran for re-election, ran for election for the first time, rather, in 1904 in Denver. And here we have Wilbur Steele's cartoon trying to dramatize what he thinks are the most important issues. So anything that strikes you about this cartoon? I don't know if we can see it from the back. It's kind of hard to see back here.
So what does the thing say by the woman? What is that little banner saying?
Honest elections.
Okay.
A little banner, like a sash, like a suffragist used to wear, actually.
Men
are stomping on her. She represents honest elections, right? And one of the most important men is Bob Speer, the boss, right here, with some of his police cronies, Democratic Party detectives, identified as here a murderer, the Iceman, and a thug. And we've got a literal smoking gun over here, right? We do things to the honest voter. So one question I had looking at this, why represent honest elections with a female figure?
Well, it sounds like the corruption was in control of the men.
Okay.
At that time.
All right.
Men were in business or politics.
Men were in power. Yeah. Men were practicing most of the corruption. There were no female office holders in Denver. There was women typically got the position of the state superintendent of education. That was considered a woman's political job. So every year a woman ran from both parties. They both put forward a woman candidate. Every year a woman won, and that was sort of the woman's political office. So you've got this one job, don't bother us otherwise. You have a question?
Oh, sorry.
I was going to say that I think a lot of our, we tend to personify a lot of like the justice, liberty as women too.
Okay. Yeah, we had Lady Liberty earlier being trampled. I kind of wonder if Wilbur Steele was influenced by that cartoon of the tiger trampling the woman who was came out about 25 years before. You might have seen it, maybe. I don't know. It's interesting.
Were women able to vote in the school board election?
Yes.
Local level
yes, women could vote at state level elections. Yes, they could vote school board, they could vote state, they could vote in national elections. They could vote for president in Colorado. Yeah. Because the rules were set by the states or by local communities.
I think to me there's something more powerful with it not being the tiger, with it not being an animal. And we actually put the man with a woman there.
Yeah.
And she's face up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In this one.
It's a really violent image,
yeah.
Isn't it? I mean, a man literally stomping on a woman like this. It's, and that's what's...
Those faces look like they're actually intended to be portraits of actual people at the time. Were they?
Yes, yes. Yes, this was meant to represent Bob Speer.
That's what he looked like.
Yeah.
And who's the city detective on the right there?
Sam Emmerich? Yeah.
Sam Emmerich.
Yeah. These folks are not particularly famous, but these are very accurate renderings of these faces. So our artists could draw a really good likeness when they wanted to.
Yeah, for sure.
So it is interesting to me as we're talking about, and maybe I'm convincing you that these gendered images are important for us to pay attention to. There's some messaging going on here, right? Representing honest elections with a female figure, representing the political corruption as a kind of violent assault, male against female. I wonder if it would generate certain feelings in male voters, like, oh, I can't let that happen, right? Hopefully.
Are they squashing women's vote, too?
Potentially, yeah. The woman's vote represented here, maybe, as well.
But are you saying that is the Democratic Party, according to what we're looking at there?
Yeah, so these were Democratic Party candidates, and the candidate here for mayor, he was on the Democratic ticket, and then we have his supporters on either side. Yeah.
So would it just be representation of We don't want that political party in power.
Could be as well, right? We want to vote for the Republican guy. Yeah. He's not featured here in any part of this cartoon, but that could be an implication. Vote for the Republican. You're right. Although we don't have the party symbols at play here. You're right.
Yeah.
So this is a young Bob Speer, Mayor Speer later on. Just briefly, a bio sketch. He arrived here in the 1870s seeking a cure for tuberculosis. Like a lot of folks came to Colorado for the dry mountain air. Rose up in the Democratic Party as an activist. Was head of the Denver board that controlled the police and fire departments. That was one way you could build your political credentials, was by working through the police and the fire departments, managing those operations. He also did work on what we would now call the Parks Department, and he became very interested in parks and boulevards and city landscaping. But he did win that election in 1904 and was elected again in 1908, and then a third time in 1916. So he was a very long-serving Denver mayor. Yeah.
So is that what Speer Boulevard is? That
yes.
Is
this is Speer Boulevard, guy. Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. So he engineered that and decided to create the retaining walls beside Cherry Creek so it wouldn't flood, because that was a periodic problem that Denver and Auraria particularly suffered from. And then, as we'll see, he's also important for the Civic Center project.
I'm surprised it hasn't been objected to. Name.
Yeah. I guess you're right. I mean, he has this start in 1904 on the backs of political corruption and accusations of voter fraud. A lot of those practices I mentioned were reported pretty widely in the press. So he did face that kind of criticism. And there was, in that context, this idea that in order to confront political corruption, Denver voters needed to organize and challenge that in some fashion. So here's where we get, again, to the sort of masculine imagery. This is another cartoon that appeared around this time. Denver represented here by a male figure who is, what is he doing? Can you tell?
Breaking his bonds.
Breaking his bonds, breaking shackles, irons, chains that have trapped him on a chair, a pedestal of corporation rule. So breaking away from the corporations, maybe? Any thoughts on what's going on with that cartoon?
Well, they tell you, but it's hard to read what's on the ribbons.
Yes. Election frauds, high taxes, gang machine, political party machine, corruption, and bossism.
So they're basically like the get out and vote, right?
Get out
Tuesday,
and vote.
Forecast for Tuesday, unless
get
you get
out and
out
vote. Right, you gotta break the bonds.
We need to do this to
yes. So in 1903, this was in the context of that debate about Denver's home rule charter. When Speer was elected, there were also pictures like this. The honest citizen had to confront the machine, the party machine. The party machine is wielding a club of fraud, unfair advantage, instead of the honest voter is preparing to use his fists,
yeah.
Fight manly, fairly, bare knuckle fighting, I guess, right? So there were a lot of images in this time period of political reform that featured male activists, male fighting, honestly. It's as if politics was some sort of aggressive, masculine sport that men were involved in. And it's weird that there weren't more images of women in these political campaigns, at least illustrated by cartoonists. Any thoughts on why? I don't know. So I'm trying to figure it out. Yeah.
I mean, just women were considered to be weak.
Okay.
They didn't much matter.
All right. They weren't maybe up for the challenge of there's a fist fight required and you're not going to ask your mom to go do that?
He might have a vote in some places, but just shh.
Okay.
Let us handle this.
Okay, all right.
The men guys can take care of it.
Yeah.
Okay, guys can take care of it. Yeah, could be. Yeah.
Women didn't have the power.
Okay.
They weren't allowed to have the power.
Right. Well, they have the vote, right? But maybe they just didn't seem to have as much power as these guys or something.
They didn't hold the positions, so they weren't
They didn't have the positions, right? Yeah, no, good point, right? They didn't have the different elected offices. They didn't control the party machines. There were women active in the Democratic Party and in the Republican Party. They typically had a women's section, a women's division. And again, women were focused on issues like schools, school board elections, so that was considered a women's issue.
So the influence they had was minimal in comparison to, even though they had the vote.
Yes.
In comparison to these guys.
Well, they're struggling, right? I mean, let's look at an example here of one of the really influential women activists in Colorado. Ellis Meredith wrote for the Rocky Mountain News for decades. She was very active in the Democratic Party. She also wrote for a newspaper that consistently supported the Democratic Party. Newspapers tended to be consistently allied with paper, with a party. So the Rocky Mountain News was known as a Democratic Party. It was owned by Thomas Paterson, who had served as the Democratic Senator for Colorado for a number of years. So she wrote a famous article for The Atlantic magazine, which is still around, in 1909, trying to explain to the rest of the United States why women should have the vote. And she wanted to demonstrate that women were making a real difference in Colorado because they had the vote at this point for about 15 years. But it's interesting the way I think she frames and focuses her argument. I've got a quote. Now, you can find it online if you want to read the whole thing. It's really interesting to read. But the woman who is interested in politics begins at home, has a vital interest in the quantity and purity of the water supply. She wants to know why the streets are not kept clean, and she is willing to help. It was the woman of Denver who prevailed on the authorities to park 23rd Avenue to put, that's called Park Avenue now in Denver, runs kind of next to Coors Field, to put up anti-expectoration, anti-spitting signs, provide garbage cans and drinking fountains on street corners. So what some reformers or some historians really have called municipal housekeeping, mm-hmm. city housekeeping, which maybe is just an extension of what moms do already at home, like taking their talents as house cleaners, family managers, caretakers of children, and extending those outward into the city and the community, right? So that might be where Ellis Meredith and some other activists like her, where women should focus their energies. Denver politics are unquestionably dirty, but Denver itself is a clean city. To be sure, the smoke consumer ordinance is not enforced, nor the Sunday or midnight closing ordinances. They were particularly, reformers like Ellis Meredith were concerned about Sunday closing laws. Most saloons were supposed to close on Sunday. It's a Sabbath, right? And they were supposed to close at midnight other nights, and they almost never did. So women were concerned about that. Again, alcohol and saloons. But Denver is run upon the principle that municipal government is business, not politics, and business must not be interfered with, so the all-night saloon flourishes. So again, the saloon comes into play, right? And we'll see a little bit more of that. So any thoughts on that quote? Yeah.
Well, I was just thinking a little bit on the slide before that, too, and as well as this one about the image of women as pure, clean, kind of elevated above the fray. So when you have the two men duking it out,
right,
the woman would never be seen in that.
Right.
But then you see here the actual issues are also put into that category.
Yeah. No, it's a good point. These are really, these are important issues for a city, aren't they? A city,
you get Lady Justice holding the scales of justice.
Uh-huh.
You get the Statue of Liberty,
uh-huh,
the woman.
The honest voter.
Right. Yeah, no, really interesting feminine images and of ideal political goals, political virtues. Yeah, and here focusing very much on nitty-gritty street issues, day-to-day city house cleaning. So she was not alone. There were other women activists who promoted what one of them called the maternal in politics. That was this woman on the right, Helen Ring Robinson. She was the first Colorado State Senator to serve as a woman. And she coined that phrase thinking that that was a way that women should be focusing their political energies as mothers, extending that outward into the broader community. So there were networks that existed outside of the political parties for women, famously called, you know, women's clubs. They started off as book clubs, but then they began to study urban problems, study the political party system problems, and they proposed their own kinds of solutions. They were important places for women to practice public speaking, to understand how local government works, and figure out, you know, how to focus their collective energies. They were also really focused on the juvenile court system. Denver had one of the very first juvenile court networks in the United States, a system of a few different courts. And they had a male judge, Ben Lindsay was his name, but he was an important ally of these activist women. But they also did try to organize outside of the political parties when it came to elections. So for instance, in 1908, when Democrat Speer ran again for office, the women organized the Women's Nonpartisan Association. Not a very exciting title, I have to say, but it was intended to give those women frustrated by the party machines some place to pull together and focus their political energies. So Democratic and Republican women joined that group to oppose Speer. In fact, they complained that Speer was the worst mayor Denver ever had when it came to protecting children from vice, from gambling, from alcohol. There were stories of young children being able to access alcohol pretty easily. Ben Lindsay, the juvenile court judge, insists that he had kids as young as 5 or 6 getting drunk in saloons. And there were no minimum age requirements that were enforced. So that was, again, another really big concern of these activist women. So we don't have them in the political cartoons in these eras, except when it comes to thinking about representations like these. So here's another Wilbur Steele cartoon that comes from Robert Speer's second campaign for mayor. So he's running again. And here you can see Steele as the cartoonist, and the Denver Post, which ran his cartoon, have switched sides a little bit, right? This is a little more of a pro Speer cartoon. So anything strike you in the cartoon?
Can you read them to us?
Sure, it's really hard to read, right? So we've got Greater Denver written right here, and then we've got Miss Denver here, because it says, it doesn't seem probable that Miss Denver will change chauffeurs, does it? So Miss Denver is here. This is Speer in the driver's seat. And up here, Speer is saying, I think he's a bit light for this heavy machine, Miss Denver. And Miss Denver is saying, do you suppose he could run it, Robert? And she seems to be indicating Speer's rival for the election over here. Horace Phelps was his name. He was the Republican candidate. I want to run it because I'm a Republican. But I don't know if you can see his
stature.
His stature right here. Tiny child almost, with a skirt, no less, too. A man wearing a little skirt with a little bonnet. And that's the Republican candidate against Mayor Speer, who's clearly in charge of the automobile, right? So here we've got, what's the suggestion about women?
Yes. They still have to be taken care of.
They need a chauffeur, they need to be driven around town.
They're in the back seat.
They're in the back seat, yes, literally, absolutely, right?
They are to look pretty.
Yeah, take care of the pretty stuff.
Right.
They were endorsing.
Right. It's a distressing kind of image, given that women are equal voters in the election, but our cartoonist is framing this in very gendered terms, isn't he? It's not particularly appealing to women who want to change things or want to have an influence to be pictured in this way. So Speer did win this election, and Phelps lost. Phelps did have the endorsement of the Women's Nonpartisan Association that I mentioned earlier. So that group of activist women who said, we don't like the candidate Speer for the Democrats, we don't like what he represents, and we want an alternative. So we're not going to necessarily go with the Republican Party machine, right? We're forming our own organization that can endorse the Republican candidate. But it wasn't particularly taken seriously in this image, was it? So we could just briefly note Speer, as you all were suggesting earlier, is famous for Speer Boulevard, for the Cherry Creek improvements, but even the Civic Center, the colonnades, the sort of Greek columns that offer a kind of almost armed embrace out in front of the city government building, city and county building of Denver. There is a really interesting Colorado Experience video about Speer and the City Beautiful movement. Colorado Experience is our sort of local Colorado Rocky Mountain PBS history series. I have the link, although that's not going to help you much, but you could go to Colorado Experience and search for Speer in the city. So he becomes an important civic reformer, actually, even though he has his start in this context of political corruption. But he does create some really important and lasting monuments and civic public spaces for us. He also created the Municipal Auditorium, which gave free concerts on Sundays as an alternative to the saloon, I guess. It's still around. It's being renovated. The Civic Auditorium is Municipal Auditorium. It's near the Civic Center and the Performing Arts Center. It's been overshadowed by those other buildings, but it was the first big performing arts center in Colorado. So if we think about these kinds of reforms and the legacy that they left us, Prohibition was clearly a really big deal. And as this cartoon suggests, Prohibition was often associated with women, activist women. So here we've got Congress, the Capitol building, and instead of Lady Liberty at the top or Columbia at the top, we've got a female figure with a bonnet representing the dry vote, the anti-alcohol vote, right? Wets were supporters of alcohol, dries were teetotalers opposed to alcohol. So we've got this Wilbur Steele cartoon acknowledging that prohibition has been nationally recognized as a reform. This was a big goal for these progressive reformers, and a lot of women activists did invest a lot of energy in this. There were efforts by some, even women activists, to try to ban prostitution in Denver. That was a tricky one to deal with. Obviously, it's been a tricky problem for millennia. But there were some who thought, well, we could create a special farm. We could move the city girls out to the farm and have them learn some hard work. You can imagine that didn't go over real well. There was that talk about getting rid of prostitution. The progressive reformers that we've seen represented here were very focused on trying to clean up Mayor Speer's act. And I think in a lot of ways they were successful. When Speer ran for his second election in 1908, there were fewer votes cast in the election, even though there were more people living in Denver than there had been in 1904. So it was as if a lot of those fraudulent ballots had been eliminated from the election in 1908. So the reformers did have that influence. And they did try to challenge party control over politics. And this is another legacy. Those Denver mayoral candidates that I featured before, they're not identified by party. Some of them have served in the state legislature for specific parties, but the Denver mayor election is nonpartisan, which I think is a legacy of this era, this reform project. We didn't talk a lot about public ownership of utilities, but that was another big concern of these kinds of reformers, given the connections between private utilities like the city walk, like the water company and the tramway company, and the different political party machines. There was also briefly a commission government experiment in Denver. The idea that we shouldn't have a mayor, we should have a group of experts serving as our leadership in government. That didn't go over well.
So is that why Speer missed that four-year period?
Yes, he chose not to run in that four-year period, partly because of some other scandals that he was involved with in 1912. But it was a brief experiment with commission government in Denver. It did not go well, and then in 1916, Denver voters overwhelmingly re-elected Spirits have come back. We really want you back, especially for the city public improvements that you've been involved with, the City Beautiful.
So the women were behind the commission idea?
They were also, a lot of the women were. A lot of the women were. And it was, again, out of frustration, I think, with the political parties, that they didn't have more power and influence within that party machine network. So they were just trying to get, how can we get around that, right? How can we have another access to power? So I did want to bring us a little bit up to date here. I'm just thinking about how our images influence voters today. So this I find, honestly, a pretty upsetting image. So, but I share it with you because this was an image that I think influenced voters in the 2016 election. And it brings to mind some issues that we confront today. How do we know who creates the images? How do we know who's paying for those kinds of images?
It's clearly the Army of Jesus.
Right. The Army of Jesus sponsors this ad, right? Today's Americans are able to elect a president with godly moral principles. So this appeared in the fall of 2016. The two candidates, of course, were Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, right? Fall of 2016. Hillary is a Satan, and her crimes and lies have proved just how evil she is. Even though Donald Trump isn't a saint, by any means, he's at least an honest man that cares only for his country.
Yeah, that's why he's indicted.
My vote goes for him, right? So, and Satan, apparently on the left, is saying, if I win, Clinton wins, and Jesus saying, God, if I can help it. So it's another masculine contest, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Arm wrestling. It's down to an arm wrestle, a battle between the two forces. Press like to help Jesus win. So just maybe you can kind of explain to us, because you're young. You've been on Facebook. What does it mean when we press like? What happens when you press like?
It increases the number of likes.
Okay.
The more it shares it with more people.
Right. So another kind of political communication we're living with, aren't we? Instead of a newspaper that you might buy and look at the cartoon and say, you know, I'm gonna bring this home and share it with my family. Now we can use our phones and like or
share
swipe.
Send it to somebody.
Share it, spread it around.
Is that a political cartoon?
So it's an image. I don't know if it's totally a cartoon, really. I think it's graphic design, but the newspaper illustrators of today may be the graphic designer. I mean, of the past, maybe the graphic designers of today. Yeah?
When did they find out that it was the Russian Internet Research Agency that
In 2017, a congressional committee began to ask Facebook, can you tell us about these ads that we're hearing? Right. Which is interesting too, isn't it? It's very hard to know on Facebook. Where does this come from? It shows up on my feed. Do I like it? Do I share it with people? And a lot of these images were shared pretty quickly in the fall of 2016. So did these influence voters, or are we all pretty savvy? Like, that's a bunch of BS. I'm not gonna buy that anymore.
I think people are becoming more savvy
as
we go through because we've been through this too often.
Okay, we're kind of learning how this system can kind of work, right? It's a different world though, isn't it? How quickly these images can be spread, and we don't know from whom.
Well, and how many Wilbur Stills were there? You know, and the Army of Jesus, I mean, those are just nonstop now.
Right.
So the sheer volume.
It is striking. It's really hard to keep up, isn't it?
Yeah. And even just words on Twitter, like without images at all.
Right, right.
Just a constant of that.
Right.
So yes.
It's a really difficult, different political landscape that we're living through. I mean, I think it's almost revolutionary how different it is from even 30 years ago, you know, before. When certainly in the age of newspapers, things just moved so much more slowly.
When did you say Facebook was invented?
2004.
Wow.
2004. So it hasn't been very long.
What happened in 2004?
Facebook was invented.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah. iPhone 2007. So only about 15
years.
And
Rocky Mountain News died out.
Yeah.
That's right. That's right. The Rocky is no more. Yes. Yes. So it is a different kind of political landscape, right? So. What do we think? Political cartoons, can they fight corruption? You were saying it depends. Is that still our answer? So I have one more for you here.
I think it depends upon the audience.
Okay.
Who's
consuming
it, who's consuming it.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because if they're persuaded, the audience is persuaded, it might make a difference on election day.
Well, if they think about it,
uh-huh.
you know, it's
uh-huh.
more of a actually analyzing what it is that's being presented to them. Is
yeah.
this real or is it not real?
Yeah, yeah.
Do I believe this or don't I believe this?
Right, right.
Do I do my own investigation into this to
right.
find out what's real and what's not real?
Yeah.
You know, it depends upon who's accepting it. Like
right.
people of the army of Jesus, they're going to say that and say,
right.
yes,
right.
they like.
You're
you
describing
know?
Such an honest voter. You give me such hope.
Oh, well.
Do people make those calculations? Did they stop and think about all those things? They're just like, oh, I remember that image from Facebook. Yeah.
I think in the context of the time that you presented to us tonight, there's so much information packed into that one frame.
Mm-hmm.
I think it could certainly be a tool
mm-hmm.
to fight corruption,
mm-hmm.
or to corrupt. But
yeah.
I think it's definitely a very effective tool.
Yeah.
Okay, it's part of that steady drumbeat. Mm-hmm. But then again, you tend to, or we all have that bias where we tend to look and follow the drumbeat
yeah.
that we
mm-hmm.
want to follow
mm-hmm.
too, or
mm-hmm.
that, you know.
Yeah,
see
no, good
it,
point.
We agree with.
Yeah.
But he signed his name too. You knew the source. I think
right.
That's true.
Right
yeah.
This is his signature here. This
yeah,
steel.
Yeah. Yeah, very good.
It was at least owned, and it was always printed in the newspaper, the Denver Post, so you
and
knew something about the Post.
We knew where they stood.
It was a kind of visual editorial in a way. Yeah, I think so too.
So did Rocky Mountain News have a cartoonist on staff that competed with Steel?
They didn't have a consistent one, not
okay.
for as long,
okay.
but they did have some.
Okay.
Yeah. And they employed some of the familiar tropes and imagery that we've been talking about here. In fact, this was Steele's version of the Rocky Mountain News right here, the News Times. They own two papers, the Denver Times. And he referred to the owner, Thomas Patterson, as the knocker in chief, the man who was always knocking things, always ragging on things, complaining about things. He's got a megaphone. Denver is ruled by criminals, thieves, grafters. Everything is on the blink. But here we have a female figure. Miss Denver, who says, take off your goggles, see what a fine, growing, prosperous city is here. You'll be surprised. So the female voice of reason in response, yeah.
And I think back in those days, those political cartoons spoke to the intellect,
mm-hmm.
spoke to the cognitive proportion,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to the army of Jesus,
mm-hmm.
goes straight for your emotions.
Yeah.
So, you know.
It is an intense emotional response people have to that. I think you're right. Yeah, that image before. It's a good point. Thank you. I don't know if I'm over time, but that's all I had. So I'm happy to chat about if you have questions or if you want to look at any more of the pictures. But I am hoping to create a collection of these Wilbur Steele cartoons and try to organize them with a little bit of context information. And I'm thinking, because I have already done this once, but I'm thinking of just posting them on the web because I want them to be accessible, and I want people to be able to engage with them a little more than they would if it was just a coffee table book.
Mm-hmm.
Also, publishers would charge a lot for a coffee table book, whereas this stuff can just go for free on the web. Because I feel like there's a bit of a movement afoot to try to copyright and charge for images on the web that I hope will be more in the public domain.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these cartoons are all in... Technically, they're in the public domain now because they were published 120 some years ago. But there is an effort, I'm drawing a blank right now. What's the firm you have to always pay for the photographs?
Shutterstock.
Yeah, Shutterstock is one. There's a number of them anyway that are kind of trying to buy up and monopolize pictures and say, yeah, I'll sell you the cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
Or
Getty Images. Yeah.
Getty Images does that as well. There's a number of them too.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's kind of my project. I appreciate you all as an audience. Thank you very much for joining tonight. I'm happy to chat about progressive politics or other politics or gender politics.
Thank you.
When you first started, I was surprised at how many of the issues that were in those early
yeah.
cartoons you showed are still
right.
with us today.
It is interesting.
And unsettled.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, maybe not the saloon as an octopus, but...
Protecting children from violence.
Protecting children.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gun violence,
yeah.
opioids.
Yeah.
I mean, you could look
yeah.
at this.
No, absolutely. There are some really
yeah.
important...
Yeah.
Internet.
I think the new octopus are things like Facebook,
yeah.
you know, TikTok, and
yeah.
you know, some of these
yeah.
other things. That's
yeah.
the octopus now.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe you could draw
screen
that cartoon
time.
For me.
That'd be a good one.
I like that. Thank you. No, I'm
I'll take
right.
your cut because it was
I
my
think
idea.
You're right. Okay. okay. No, it's great. It's great. I wish I were a visual artist because I would draw that one. No, I agree. It
just
is.
Take
it
steals
is
and change the lettering on it.
Yeah. yeah.
Well, yeah, and even it, like the industrial side of, you know, the working conditions and things, but now you look at it more of like tech and,
yeah.
and
mm-hmm.
like
mm-hmm.
workers'
mm-hmm.
rights or, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it just has kind of transposed to
yeah.
today's day.
It is interesting. The workers' issues are different, but similar too, you're
yeah.
right, in some ways. Yeah, it is interesting to think about.
Did you look at political cartoons of more recent times in comparison to how they handle the issues
yeah.
And the different kinds of illustrations?
Yeah, and that's something I'd like to do in this project that I'm working on, you know, Herblock and some of those cartoonists from more recent
yeah.
years. There are still some practicing, you know, I mean, the Denver Post and other newspapers do feature political cartoonists, so they are out there, but I think they have a little bit less of an influence. I think they're more in the graphic designers now working for Facebook, honestly, or Meta.
I don't
but,
do Facebook. So
but, but yeah, no, you're right. It would be, it's important, I think, to think about that kind of bigger context, for sure. But as, you know, as movies and television becomes more important, I think the political cartoon in the newspaper seems a little quaint,
yeah.
a little bit old-fashioned, and that starts even in the 50s, 1960s. You know, people are getting news from television primarily, and there's no comparable form like a political cartoon
and
at that point.
Political cartoons probably started with newspapers then?
Yes.
And how long
yes.
ago that would have been even earlier than...
Yeah, there were some, what we might call periodicals now, there are some dating back to the 1700s, time of the American Revolution and the French Revolution. There are some cartoons that you can look at then too. Yeah, for sure.
Very interesting.
Yeah. Fun stuff, I know. Pictures worth a thousand words, right?
Yeah.
It's just so
yeah.
fun to talk about. Yeah.
Why does it say R. Loudon? In your email address,
oh.
your name is Todd Loudon.
Right, my first name is Robert.
Okay.
So I'm using my middle name. My father's also a Robert, but
all right.
he's not a Robert Todd, so I just want to just do Todd. Yeah, thank you. But yeah, that's my email address. And if you're ever interested in taking classes at Metro or auditing at Metro, we'd love to have you. We teach a whole bunch of really fun history classes.
Yeah, thank you.
Well,
thank
thanks.
You.
Well, thank you so much for presenting. We really
sure.
appreciate it. And
yeah,
if you have questions, you can obviously send an email. You can also send them to me, and I'm happy to forward them on if you
okay.
have any questions later.
Great.
And I think if you do compile a lot of those our political cartoons, I think it'd be something fun for the museum to share as well.
Okay.
Say, this is a presenter we had. And
sure, I'll let you know.
So,
I'll let you know,
yeah.
yeah. No, I'm working on it.
Well, thank you so much,
thanks.
And thank you everyone for joining us this evening.
Yeah. Thanks.
I like your other super screen.